Okay, so I'm not able to open.
Is the screen visible to everyone?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so what is the aim of our experiment today? The aim is to measure the power in a three-phase system using two wattmeter method. Okay, this is the aim of our experiment today. Now we know what is power in a three-phase system. We have seen in what is a three-phase system in the previous experiment number four. If you have the re if we do the recap, what did we study? That for a three-phase system we have two types of connections. Okay, one is a star connection, the other one is a delta connection. In star connection, we know that there are three terminals which are coming out along with a common terminal which is neutral. So this is R, Y, B, and this is the neutral point. Whereas for a delta connection, we know that it is a closed loop. If I say this is R, this is R dash, this is Y, this is Y dash, and this is B, which is B dash. Remember, the start delta connection is where the ending of the first coil is connected to the starting of the second coil. The ending of second coil is connected to the starting of third coil, and the ending of third coil is connected to the starting of first coil. Right? So this forms a closed loop, forming a closed loop delta connection. Right? And what are the terminals which are available to us? The terminals which are available are, and let's say this is Y, and this terminal is B. These are the three RYB terminals available to us. What were the relations which we derived in the previous session, last experiment? Who will tell me what is the relation between the line current and the phase current for a star connection, and line voltage and phase voltage? What is the relationship? Can anyone tell? In the previous session, we had derived it. Who will tell me? Should I ask one by one everyone? No. रोल नंबर 20 आप बताओगे? रोल नंबर 20, आर यू देयर? 29, 30,
प्रेजेंट सर।
या 30? कैन यू टेल मी व्हाट इज द रिलेशनशिप बिटवीन स्टार एंड द स्टार कनेक्शन लाइन एंड फेज क्वांटिटीज फॉर लाइन करंट एंड फेज करंट? रोल नंबर 30?
नो नो सर।
नो, यू हैव नॉट अटेंडेड प्रीवियस सेशन?
आई एम आउट ऑफ स्टेशन।
बट दैट डज नॉट मीन दैट यू शुडंट आंसर। और
मीन्स प्रीवियस लेक्चर में मैं आउट ऑफ स्टेशन
अच्छा, आपने अटेंड नहीं किया था प्रीवियस सेशन?
हूँ, रिकॉर्डिंग देखनी है, बाकी है अभी।
ओके, सो हु विल टेल मी? रोल नंबर 56, विल यू टेल? What is the relationship between star quantity, the line and phase quantities for a star connection? 56, 58, 55, 50, 54. Because you people are not answering. Next week will be the assessment for you people. Okay, five experiments will be completing, and next week will be the assessment in which I'll be asking you, I'll be evaluating you for these five set of experiments, how much you have studied, how much you have understood, whether your lab record is complete or not. So the next week will be your assessment. So please prepare for that, since I can see that you people have not even prepared for the previous session, जो हमने last week किया था. So you won't get marks if you are performing like this. So in star connection, I'll just write down quickly. Anyone wants to write down, wants to tell what is the relationship?
They are equal. Line current is equal to phase current in star connection.
Roll number 35.
Yes, sir.
Line current is equal to phase current. Good. What about line voltage and phase voltage?
In line voltage
3 times phase voltage.
Root 3 times.
This is basically root 3 times, right?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. And what about for a delta connection?
Connection, they both are equal.
Delta connection, what about the line current and phase current?
Root 3 times.
Both are equal, sir.
Who is saying equal?
60
the 60, both are not equal, the line current and phase current.
Sir, root 3
the voltage
times.
Are equal.
Yeah, I was asking about the current.
Voltage are equal, not current, voltage are equal.
Yeah, the voltages are same, but the currents are not
yes,
same.
Sir. Current are not same.
The current is root 3 times the phase current, right? This we had derived in the previous session. This is our basic verification, right? We had seen what was the theory behind this, and we verified also in the previous session. So this is a three-phase system. Now, to measure the power for this three-phase system, we are going to use a 2 wattmeter method. So first of all, you should know what is a wattmeter. What is a wattmeter? It is a measuring instrument, electrical measuring instrument. Right? What does it measure?
Yes, sir. Electrical power. Rate of flow of electricity.
To measure the power consumed in the circuit. Consumed. When I say consumed, what do you understand by consumed? Power consumed in a circuit. So you have studied in your basic, you are studying also in the theory portion that there are basically R, L, N, C, three elements, circuit elements, which are important and we study extensively about resistance, inductance and capacitors, right? So for a resistance, we know that whenever current flows through this resistance, what happens? I square into R. What is this? This is nothing but the power associated with the resistance. So this much amount of power is actually being consumed by the resistance. We say that this is being consumed. Means this amount of power is actually taken by the resistance, and if you multiply it by time, that will be nothing but I square into R into T. This much amount of energy is actually lost in terms of heat. Whereas for an inductor and capacitor, what happens whenever current flows through them? For an inductor, magnetic field is set up and the energy is stored in the inductor. We call that energy as half L I square. And for a capacitor, it is half C V square. So we don't say that power is consumed in this inductor or a capacitor. The energies, or we can say power, is only associated, that power is stored in the inductor in terms of magnetic field setup, and for a capacitor it is in terms of the electric field setup by the capacitor. So after some time, this power is again released back in the circuit. So that is the difference when we talk about power consumed. But wattmeter, what does it do? It does not give us the power associated with an inductor or a capacitor. It only tells us how much is the power consumed. That is why I have written the term power consumed. And only element which consumes power in an electrical circuit is actually a resistance. Right? So it tells us basically how much power is being consumed by the resistive part of your complete electrical circuit. That is the meaning of power consumed, and that is the work or measured quantity by a wattmeter. Now, this is a measuring instrument. That means it has some constructional features. So what are the constructional features? Basically, I'll just tell you first what is the symbol of a wattmeter. Okay, so the symbol of wattmeter we can write on in this particular way. So it is represented inside this circle. You can see that I have drawn connections in this particular fashion. So how many terminals are actually coming out of this wattmeter? You can see, which are coming out of the circle. Okay, this is wattmeter W. So one of the terminals which is coming out is named as M, the main line, main coil, and this is L, this is C, and this is V. Out of which C is inside this particular circle only whenever we draw, even though the terminals are actually brought out and we connect it externally, C and V, and V is the last terminal which is coming out. So what are these terminals basically? The terminals M and L are those between which you can see that there is a coil which I have represented. So whenever I draw something like this, it represents a coil. So this coil is actually known as a current coil. I'll represent it as CC, current coil. Whereas you can see that I have represented a resistor here between C and V, right? So this is a common point. This is known as the common point C, which is connected to M. And the other point is known as the voltage point, okay, voltage, terminal voltage coil. So this resistance is actually representing a voltage coil or a pressure coil. So there are two coils here. One is a current coil, CC, and then there is a pressure coil. Or we also call this as the voltage coil, and that is represented by PC or VC, voltage coil or pressure coil. Now this coil, since its representation is in terms of an inductor, this is highly inductive, okay, and this coil is basically represented as a resistor. That means this is highly resistive. Now why are we using these two coils, or how do we connect this wattmeter in the circuit here? So whenever I want to measure, for example, the power consumed by this particular load, let's say this is my load, okay, so if I'm having this wattmeter, what I'll do, I'll connect this. If let's say from at this side we are having some supply, AC supply, and we want to connect, we want to measure how much is the power being consumed by this particular load. So how will we connect? We'll connect it like this. Basically between the supply and load, we'll connect this wattmeter in this particular fashion. Now you can see how we have connected this. The current coil is always connected in series with the load. Okay, it's always connected. You can see this current coil is actually connected in series with the load, whereas this pressure coil or the voltage coil, it is actually connected parallel to the load. You can see it is connected parallel to the load here. It is highly resistive and connected parallel to the load. Now why it is connected parallel to the load? Because we want to measure the voltage across it. So we'll see why this wattmeter, or why this type of a connection leads to the measurement in terms of power. Okay. Now always remember that this is an electrical measuring instrument, and you might have seen your voltmeter, ammeters, basic meters in your 12th standard also, in your science laboratory. So what have you seen in your measurement, in your ammeter in your 12th standard? You might have seen that there is a box in which there are terminals like this, and there is a glass on top in which inside there is a spindle at this point, and there is a scale like this. Like this, there is a scale, and there is a needle here, and this needle actually deflects whenever this device is connected to your circuit. There is a deflection in this particular needle, isn't it? So similarly here also, we have a represent, a wattmeter also has a similar setup. Only thing is that it has not just two connections, it has four connections actually, M, L, C and V, where in this particular case M and C are actually joined together. M and C are joined together, and that total connection is connected to M, okay, and L is actually connected to the load because this coil has to be in series. Similarly, the V terminal which is coming out is actually connected to this particular point in the parallel to the load, so that this coil is actually parallel to the load. Fine. So wattmeter also has a structure in this particular way. It is also a deflecting type instrument. It's a basically electrodynamometer type instrument. When we define a wattmeter, it's an electrodynamometer type instrument. So we get a deflection whenever some current flows through it, and some power is actually being transferred from this source to the load. There is a deflection in this wattmeter. So what is this deflection telling us? Always remember that for any electrical instrument, the deflection torque, okay, so the deflection torque is directly proportional always to the current flown through the current carrying coil, this current coil, multiplied by the current flowing through the pressure coil or the voltage coil. Always the deflection will be proportional to the magnitude of the currents flowing, because essentially what is happening is one main current, one main coil through which current is flowing, and then parallelly there is another current flowing. There are two currents now. So if I want to use another color here, so I can say that the current flowing through this is ICC and the current flowing through this is IPC. Okay, so these two are the currents flowing through the wattmeter. So the deflection torque, or this deflection, basically this is the deflection torque, right? So this deflection torque will be proportional to the magnitude of currents flowing through these two, because they will produce their own individual fluxes and they will be at an angle to each other, and as a result of which they will have a deflection torque among them. So one of them is actually fixed, the other one will be movable, as a result of which one of the coils, which is movable coil, is actually connected to this particular, you can say, the spindle, and it rotates because of the deflection torque. Now in case of the current coil, that is remaining the same, that means this is directly proportional to I of the current coil. But what about the pressure coil? What is the current pressure coil? Basically IPC is the current flowing through this, and it's, you know, it's a very highly resistive circuit. And what is the voltage coming across this pressure coil? The voltage across the load, okay. VL, I'm calling this as VL, the voltage across the load. And what is the current flowing through the current coil? If I say what is the current flowing through the current coil, this is nothing but IL. So I can say that this is ICC, or the same value as IL, multiplied by what is IPC, the pressure coil current. This pressure coil current will be the same as the voltage applied across it divided by the resistance value. Because it's highly resistive, that means it obeys Ohm's law, and as per Ohm's law, we know current is directly proportional to V divided by R, isn't it? So this IPC will be directly proportional to the voltage across this coil, voltage across the pressure coil, divided by the resistance of the pressure coil. Now this will be a fixed value, resistance of the pressure coil, and since it is directly proportional, we can take that as a, in terms of the constant of proportionality. So I can say that this is nothing but directly proportional to the current flowing through the load, multiplied by what is the voltage across this, that is nothing but load voltage to VL. This divided by RPC is coming in terms of this constant of since it's proportional only we are writing. So this deflection torque is actually, you can see, it is directly proportional to the product of VL into IL. What is this? Basically VL into IL, this is the current flowing through this load, or instead of IL, I can say this is the current flowing through this particular phase, and this is the voltage across this phase. So instead of that, I'll write down current flowing through the phase and voltage across this phase. So basically deflection torque is directly proportional to the product of voltage and current. That means this deflection torque, okay, this will be deflecting, this spindle will be deflecting by how much quantity? By the quantity which is depending upon the product of voltage and current. And what is the quantity which depends upon the product of voltage and current? That is nothing but the power which is consumed by that particular phase. So basically this deflection torque will actually be giving us how much is the power consumed in this phase. Okay. So that is the concept behind your wattmeter. It has two coils, current coil and pressure coil. Because of the current flow in both these coils, there is a deflection. This deflection torque is directly proportional to the product of these two currents. Whereas one of the coils is a highly inductive coil, the other one is a highly resistive coil. As a result of which, we can write down that current of the pressure coil as voltage across it divided by resistance due to Ohm's law. And it gives us a relationship that the deflection torque is directly proportional to phase voltage multiplied by phase current, which is nothing but equal to the power consumed in the phase. Fine. So that is about how the in a brief we can understand how the wattmeter consumes power in this particular circuit. Fine. Now, since we know that this wattmeter is measuring power because of the product of current carrying in the current coil and the pressure coil, now let us move on to our three-phase circuit and how to measure the power here, how to find out the power measurement. Now, for power measurement, I told you that we are having two circuits, two types of circuits. One is a star, the other one is a delta connection. Now, let's say my load is first connected in star. So in star, we know this is how we connect the load. I hope I'm audible to everyone. Please confirm once.
Yes, sir. You are audible.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Because these are important topics, conceptual topics, three-phase star connection and everything. So we have, either you can have a three-phase system which can be represented by the phase sequence RYB, or you can also use the phase sequence ABC. Any of these you can use. The most popularly used is RYB. We can go with ABC also. It just tells us that it's a three-phase system. Okay, this is the basic nomenclature. So, because some people have the doubt in terms of R is coming, then whether B is coming or whether Y is coming and so on. Okay, so we can also use this ABC sequence. So, for example, let's say I'm saying this is my A phase. This is the B phase. B phase, this is the C phase. So this is so this is my A, this is B, and this is C, which is the terminals which are available to us. You can see that it is a star connection, though there is a neutral point also, which if we want we can take it out also. Now for delta, if we connect this load, what will happen for delta connection? So I'm connecting this load like this. This A phase, then this is your B phase, and this is the B phase, this is the C phase. Now this is A, this is B, and this is the C phase. Just writing it again, A, B, C. Now we need to find out how much is the power consumed in this circuit, isn't it? So what we'll do, let the current flowing through this, I'm going to write down with another color. Current flowing through this phase, IA. This is IB. This is IC. okay, and the voltage across this space, I am saying that it is VAN, this is VBN in this particular direction, and this is VCN. Now, what will be the power consumed in this three-phase circuit? You know that this will be nothing but the sum of all the three powers. So that will be VAN multiplied by IA plus VBN multiplied by IB plus VCN multiplied by IC. This is the power in the three-phase circuit here. Okay. Now, if I connect for the star connection, so let me just erase this and draw here to measure the power. So what I'm going to do is I am connecting a wattmeter here. Wattmeter W1. I am connecting this particular fashion. This is W1. And you can see that the current coil is connected in series with phase A of W1. And the pressure coil is connected between the lines A and B. These are the line terminals between A and B. Now, the second wattmeter I am connecting in the third phase. Okay. So this is the current coil in the third phase, and the pressure coil, the voltage coil, I am connected across this third phase and this same B phase. This is my second wattmeter. This is W2. These are already available to us, these points. This is B, this is A, this is C. So I'll just this is W2. And what about in this particular case, for if it's a delta connection, then current flowing through A phase, let me call this IA. This is IB and this is IC. The voltage across this, what is the voltage across this point is at A and this point is at B. So the voltage here will be VAB. What is the voltage across this phase? This is point B. This is point C. So this will be VBC. And what is the voltage across this phase? This is at point C and this is point A. So this will be VCA. So if I want to find out the power in three phase circuit for a delta connection, again it is sum of all the three phase powers, right? So I can write down this as VAB, the voltage across the phase multiplied by IA, phase current, plus VBC multiplied by IB, plus CA, the voltage across this phase multiplied by the current flowing through that phase, that is VIC, VCA into IC. This will be basically sum of all the three individual cases, the power consumed, and that will be the total three phase power. Similarly, for a star connection also, we have written the individual sum of all the individual power should be equal to my three phase power. Now, we have connected these two wattmeters. This is the two wattmeter method we are using, right? So only two wattmeters we are connecting, and we have connected it in such a way that W1 is connected with the current coil in phase A, and the voltage coil, or you can write down here for W1, the current coil is in phase A and voltage coil is between A and B. Similarly, for wattmeter W2, what we do, we connect the current coil in the phase C, like it is in series with phase C, whereas the voltage coil is connected between phase C and phase B, phase C and phase B, between C and B here. We can see here that this phase B, okay, this phase B is taken as the common phase here. So two wattmeters are connected in such a way that current coils are connected in two coils in series, and the voltage coil is connected between those two individual coils and the third phase, which is taken as the common. So here phase B is taken as the common phase. So this is the way we connect the two wattmeter method. Now, how to measure power using this? Okay, how will we be able to measure the power using such a wattmeter connection? Let us see. So we had seen in a previous discussion also, what is wattmeter actually telling us? Wattmeter is telling us the power consumed in that particular phase. So how, where is the wattmeter W1 connected? Current coil is in phase A and voltage coil is in phase across phase A and B. So W1 reading, what will be the W1 reading here will be depending upon the current flowing through the, because these all values which we have written here are all instantaneous values. These all are instantaneous values. All these are instantaneous values. That means for W1, whenever we are writing, we'll be writing down this as the current flowing. What is the current flowing through this wattmeter, through the current coil? IA, right? IA is the same current which is flowing through this. So I'll write down the current flowing through this is IA. Since it is with respect to time, instantaneous value, I'm writing down IA of t. Multiplied by what is the voltage across it? What is the voltage which is coming across it? Across this particular wattmeter. The wattmeter is connected between A and B, right? So that will be nothing but V AB with respect to time. Similarly, what is the wattmeter 2 depending upon? Wattmeter W2 will be depending upon current carrying coil is this one. It is connected with the phase C in series. So it will depend upon the current in current coil multiplied by the voltage across this pressure coil. What is the voltage across this pressure coil? This is connected between C and B, right? So we will write down this as VCB instantaneous. But what are these two instantaneous voltages, VAB? VAB is basically nothing but the potential difference between A and B line. Can we write down that in terms of the phase voltages? Yes, we can write down. So this can be written as IA instantaneous multiplied by VAB. Can be written as A is the potential at this point, and it is VAN voltage with respect to N. I can write down this as VAN with respect to time minus potential of B with respect to N. What is that? VBN with respect to time. Right, with respect to neutral, we know this is the voltage, or you can also write down KVL in this loop like this. So VAB will be nothing but VAN minus VBN. So VAN of time instantaneous minus VBN instantaneous. So what will be this value? We can write down this as IA this is IA multiplied by VAN minus IA multiplied by V IAN of T multiplied by VBN of T. This is the reading of wattmeter W1. Similarly, wattmeter W2 reading can be written as IC instantaneous multiplied by what is VCB? Similarly, VCB is the voltage across this terminal and B terminal. C is having a terminal voltage of or potential of VCN with respect to neutral minus B is having a voltage of VN with respect to neutral. So this can be written as ICT into VCN minus IC multiplied by V. If so, these are the two wattmeter readings W1 and W2. If we add W1 plus W2, what we will get? If we add these two wattmeter readings, वी आर गेटिंग आई ए इंटू वी एन. सो एडिंग दीज टू, आई एम जस्ट एडिंग द टर्म्स हियर, पॉजिटिव टर्म्स हियर फर्स्ट, आई सी एन इंटू वी सी एन माइनस दिस एंड माइनस दिस. सो इफ आई टेक माइनस कॉमन, सो वॉट आई एम गेटिंग, VBN is common here for both these two terms, isn't it? So I can take that VBN common minus VBN, I can take common. What I'm getting here is IA plus IC. Obviously, this is all instantaneous quantities, IAT plus IC of T. Now, in this particular case, star connection, what can we see? IA, IB, and IC, they all are meeting at this point, and we are not taking any neutral connection. That means if you write down KCL at the neutral point, what can we say? Sum of all entering currents should be equal to leaving currents. But here all are entering currents. So all currents meeting at a point should be, sum of those currents should be zero. So I can say that IA plus IB plus IC should be equal to zero here. Or I can write down this as IA plus IC can be written as minus of IB, right? IA plus IC can be written as minus of IB. So this IA plus IC I am going to substitute here as minus of IB. So what I'm getting now, W1 plus W2 is equal to VAN. T I am just removing here. We know that these are instantaneous values. So VAN into IA plus PCN into IC, and IA plus IC is minus of IB multiplied by minus of VBN will be nothing but plus VBN into IA plus IC is minus IB. So this will be IB. What are we getting here? We can see that this is sum of this VAN IA is phase A power. This is phase B power. Sorry, phase C power, and this is phase B power. And if you see the equation here, which we had written, three phase power, VAN into IA plus VCN into IC plus VBN into IB. This is coming out to be the same. So what is this telling us? That this is nothing but the three phase power of the circuit. So what can we prove from here? That power in a three phase circuit can be found out by connecting the two wattmeter meter. The two wattmeters in this particular fashion, okay, by taking one phase in common and connecting the current coils in the other two phases and voltage coil in those two phases and with respect to this common point. If we get W1 and W2 and we add them, then sum of these two wattmeter readings will give you what is the total three phase power consumed in the circuit. Is it clear? Please confirm whether this is clear to everyone or not. Yeah. So this is the three phase power consumed in the circuit now. Now we have written everything in the terms of the instantaneous values. All these are instantaneous values. Okay, and W1 and W2, you can see how we are connected. Same can be proved for a delta connection also. If you do this, you can try that as a homework. Draw this connection in this particular same fashion and find out what is W1 and W2, add W1 and W2, and in the end, you will be able to prove that this is equal to VAB into IA plus VBC into IB plus VCA into IC, which is nothing but the three phase power consumed in the circuit. So, three phase power can be measured by using the two wattmeter method. This is known as meter method of power measurement. So what is the significance here? Even though we are having three phases, right? We are having three phases here, but we don't need three wattmeters. We need only two wattmeters to measure the total three phase power. That is the significance. One less wattmeter we are requiring than the number of phases. So that is the significance here, two wattmeter method. Now this method is valid for, this is valid for both balanced as well as unbalanced load, for both balanced and unbalanced load. This is valid for both balanced and unbalanced loads. And we can also say that this is valid for both star and delta connections. Valid for both star as well as delta connections. So this analysis, whatever we have done, we have assumed that we are just having loads. Okay. Now these loads could be balanced loads or it could have been unbalanced load. Whatever be the case, we have just taken the currents and voltages which are associated with those particular three phases and found out the relationship for the three phase power in terms of W1 and W2. So this wattmeter method, two wattmeter method, is valid for power measurement for both balanced as well as unbalanced load. Now we are going to take a special case out of this. Okay, the special case that is only for balanced three-phase loads, or balanced three-phase system. What do you mean by balanced system? What is balanced and unbalanced? Can anyone tell? Balance means that the source voltages, the three phases, right? We have voltages VAN, VBN, and VCN. We know that these are three phase voltages. They all are 120 degree apart. Yes, 55, you want to speak?
Sir, in terms of load, that means capacity? You mean balance in terms of load?
What I mean is the balanced or unbalanced system. So it can be in terms of the load, yes.
Sir, means there is an equal amount of load on both the sides. Like 20 watt on both sides.
Both sides means which both sides?
Sir, balance means three phase only means if we count from wattmeter, then the power supplies we get from both sides. If we measure, then it's equal.
So basically, it's not exactly what you're saying. Some part of that may be correct. So let's say if you're having a three-phase system here, right? So when do we say that this is balanced? We say that this is a balanced system when the voltage coming across all the three phases, that is VAN, VBN, VCN, even though we know that all are 120 degree apart, that is why we draw it like this. We have seen that, right? That all the three voltages are 120 degree apart in a three-phase system. So, but their magnitudes are, we know that all are equal. So the magnitudes of all the three phases should be equal. But the voltages of a balanced three-phase system, they will all have equal magnitudes. VAN, VBN, VCN, all the three magnitudes will be same. And when we say that the load is balanced, if we talk about the load is also balanced, then that means that the impedance offered by all the three phases is the same. So if this is having an impedance Z, this is also having an impedance Z, this is also having an impedance Z. So all are having equal impedance. Now what will such a system do? If the voltages across them, VAN, this is VBN, and this is VCN, right? These are the voltages which are balanced, that means they are equal magnitudes, and they all are having the same amount of load connected to this. All impedances in the three phases are also same. Then VAN divided by Z will be nothing but IA, VBN by Z will be IB, and VCN by Z will be IC. Then in that particular case, the currents which are drawn by individual phases will also be the same, right? So we say that in that particular case, IA and IB and IC, they all are equal in magnitude also. So this system, if the system is in this particular way, where the set of three phase voltages are balanced at the input, at the load side, they are also balanced, and the load is equal in all the three phases, then we say that it is a balanced three phase system. But in case of unbalance, when does an unbalance happen? It can happen in many different ways, but let's say the general way is that the loads are different. That means if it is z by 2, this is z, and again this is 2z, then what will happen? The currents, even though the voltages are balanced here, magnitudes are balanced, these are not same, right? In that particular case, these three currents will not remain the same. So such a system, we say that it is an unbalanced system. Okay, so even if the system is balanced or unbalanced, this 2 wattmeter method, the way we have connected the wattmeters, okay, using 2 wattmeters, if we add these two sum of all the two readings, then we'll get the 3 phase power consumed in the circuit for both either balanced or unbalanced system for both star or delta connections. Now what we are going to focus is especially on the balanced 3 phase system, where this is the system here, all the 3 phase currents are same, 3 phase voltages are same magnitude, and impedance are also same. Okay, now this following analysis is for that specific system. Now the load, we can take any specific load. In the earlier example, for proving it, we had taken a resistive load. So let us take the general example. Load, we can take any given load. It can be purely resistive. It can be an RL load. It can be an RC load, and so on. It can be any one of these. So what we'll focus here is the most general load which is available to us, because majority of the load which we are having in our households as well as industries everywhere, it's an inductive load. It has some amount of resistance, equivalent resistance, and some inductive nature. So we call or we classify these loads as RL loads. Well, let us take an example for an RL load. If it's an RL load, then I can write down the impedance of this RL load as R plus J times XL, isn't it? If it's an inductive load, R plus J times XL. Now, just a second. Yeah, so we are having this R load, RL load, so it can be written as a combination of R and L. That means if I want to represent it in this particular fashion, this is nothing but a series combination of R and L, R plus J times XL, where XL is omega into L. Now for such a load, if this is the load, what will be the relationship between the current flowing through the load? If I write down the current here, the current is I, and the voltage is, let's say, V across this. So what will be the relationship between current and voltage? It's an inductive load. For a pure inductor, we had seen that current will be lagging the voltage by 90 degree. But it's an RL load now, so it will not lag by 90 degree, but it will be lagging because it's an inductive load. If I want to draw the phasor diagram here for this, just this RL load representation, then how will it be? Yes, 55, you want to say?
Sir, your voice is cracking. It's not clear.
My voice is not audible properly. Please, yes. Please, others also, just check whether this is audible to you.
It's yeah, audible.
Yeah, it is audible to everyone. So please, 55, check your own connection. Maybe it is an issue from your side. Okay, so let's take that. This is my voltage phasor. Okay. The voltage across the load, total voltage V for this RL circuit. Now we need to draw, this is along the x-axis. Okay. Now to draw the phasor for the current flowing through this, where will this be? this will be lagging the voltage, not by 90 degree, but some other angle. So I will be somewhere here. And this basically will be an angle. We can call this as angle phi. Right, this is along zero, our horizontal axis. Current is lagging, not by 90 degree, because it is a resistance also present in the circuit. If it was pure inductor, this I would have been somewhere here. Phi would have been 90. But what is phi here? In this particular case, phi value will be nothing but tan inverse omega L divided by R. For using this inductor R plus GX also, we can find out what is phi. Phi is nothing but tan inverse imaginary part divided by R, that is XL divided by R. But what is XL? XL is nothing but omega into L divided by R. And if I ask you to write down what is the temporal frame representation, this is the phasor representation, right? Temporal frame means with respect to time, how it is varying. Then how will you write down? If V is equal to Vm sine omega t, okay? If this is the expression, temporal frame, then what will be the current here? The current flowing through this I should be written as Vm by Z sine omega t minus phi. Omega t minus phi. Why? Because this current will be lagging the voltage here by an angle of phi. And the magnitude of that will be Vm divided by Z, where Z is R plus GXL, and this Z is nothing but the magnitude of Z, which is root of R square plus XL square. So this is something which you already know for an RL series connection, RL load, what happens to the relationship between voltage and current. Current lags the voltage by an angle phi, where phi is tan inverse of omega L divided by R. Okay, and the current will be lagging the voltage. So we have taken that particular example as a load. If it was a purely resistive load, then current and voltage would always be in series, in same phase. For an RC load, current will be leading the voltage by some particular angle phi. Just the opposite of this. If it is a RC connection, then you would say that current will be somewhere here. This will be IC. Okay, leading by some angle phi. So, but we are going to focus on the most generalized load which we have, which is an RL load. Now, to understand this for a balanced three-phase system, what we are going to do is we are going to draw the phasor diagram. Okay, so let's say the phase voltage is same color here now. The phase voltage VAN is VAN. Then 90 degree lagging to this has to be phase B, BN, and 90 degree, so not 90, 120 degree, okay. So this is 120 degrees. Again, 120 degrees lagging to this will be your V, BN. Okay. 120 degrees. These are the voltage phases, VAN, VBN and VCN. Always please make it to the scale that all these are equal magnitudes. I might have drawn it in not a scale, but always draw it in scale. Try to draw it in scale. Now, what we are supposed to find out here? For a balanced three-phase system, these are the phase voltages. Now, we are connecting the wattmeters here, right? Where the wattmeters connected in phase A and the voltage is across AB. So what will this wattmeter reading tell us? Wattmeter reading W1. This will be equal to the current which is flowing in this particular phase, right? IA will be directly proportional to this current. That is IA multiplied by the voltage across AB, that is VAB the voltage across AB. But now what we are writing down here, these are not just magnitudes, these are now phasor quantities. So IA multiplied by VAB, right? Whenever we talk about phases, there is some angle also. Earlier we had written everything in terms of instantaneous values, so that instantaneous value itself is covering the voltage equation. That means this instantaneous values is the temporal frame representation. This is V of t, okay, Vm sin omega t. This is I. I is Vm by Z sin omega t minus phi. So whenever I multiply these two, right, instantaneous values, already these two terms, this phi angle is already coming in picture. But whenever I talk about phases, these two are magnitudes. Okay, so let me just erase these. These two are magnitudes, but the angle is not coming in picture when I talk about the phasor already in this equation. So I have to use that angle separately. So wattmeter W1 will be giving us the reading correspondingly to the current flowing through this phase, W, where it is. This W1, that is IA multiplied by the voltage across this VAB, multiplied by the angle between these two quantities. Okay, multiplied by angle between, and which angle? Cos of the angle between IA phasor and VAB phasor. IA phasor and VAB phasor. Similarly, W2 is connected here. Just remember where we have connected. So this is coil here, connected like this, and second wattmeter is connected in this particular fashion. This is W2, this is W1. For W2, it is connected, current coil is IC. So magnitude of this multiplied by between C and B, CB magnitude, multiplied by cos of the angle between these two phasors. So that is IC phasor multiplied by V CB phasor. Now we have with us voltage phases of each phase, VAN, VBN and VC. But what we require are VAB and VCB. Okay, so let us find out VAB and VCB. So where is VAB? VAB will be nothing but VAN minus VBN. We had seen in our previous session also. So VBN is here. That means this will be minus VBN. Okay. And sum of these two phasors will give you what is the resultant phasor. So just draw parallel to this. Complete the parallelogram. And the resultant of these two, you can use another color here. And draw it like this. So this is your VAB phasor. Right? Similarly, where will be VCB phasor? Next is what we have to draw is IC into VCB. Where is VCB? VCB will be nothing but VCN minus VBN. So VCB, VCN is here, minus VBN is already here. So if you add these two phasors, just complete the parallelogram here. So if I complete this parallelogram and join together the resultant, try to draw a straight line here, we'll get the resultant here, V C B phasor. And next, what is asked to us, we need to find out which is IC, IA, IC. These two phases also we need to find out. So where is IA and IC? So IA and IC are basically the current flowing through them, these phases, IB, IC. Now, depending upon the load here which we have is inductive load. So whatever the voltage across phase, the current in that phase will be lagging by an angle of phi. And since this is a balanced system, right? So the magnitude of this Z will be the same. ZA will be the same as ZB, will be the same as ZC. Right? As a result, the angle phi for all the three phases will be the same. That means the angle by which the current in all three phases lags the respective voltages will be the same, and that will be phi itself. So if I want to draw the currents by another color, so let me blue color. So if VAN is the phase voltage, then current will be, current in that particular phase will be lagging the voltage here by an angle of phi. So this is IA is lagging by an angle of phi. This angle is phi. Similarly, for B phase, IB will be lagging the voltage by the same angle phi. So this is IA, will be IB. For BC, will be lagging, will be, all will be lagging by the same angle phi. This phi, voltage by phi. What is the angle between? What we want is cos of angle between IA and VAB. So IA is here, VAB is here, and we know that since this is a parallelogram here, we know that this angle is 60 degrees. Why? Because if this is VAB and VBN and V minus VBN, this is total 180 degrees, out of which this is 120 degrees. Out of 180 degrees, if this is 120, then remaining is 60 here. Isn't it? Now we know since this is the rhombus here, essentially these two are all equal sides, then the diagonal actually bisects the angle here, each angle. So we know that this angle is 60 degree, that means this angle should be 30 degrees. This angle should also be 30 degrees. But what we want is the angle between VAB and IA, right? VAB and IA phases. So IA is here and VAB is here. So the angle between both of them is nothing but 30 plus phi. So if I want to write down that, I can write down what is W1 reading. W1 reading is nothing but IA multiplied by VAB multiplied by cos of the angle between them is 30 plus phi. Right? What about W2? W2 is IC multiplied by VCB multiply by cos of the angle between IC and VCB. What is the angle between IC and VCB? You can see IC is here and VCB is here. What is the angle between them? Let us see quickly what is the angle. So this total angle here, since this is a parallelogram which is formed here, this total angle will be 30 degrees because the resultant here, because if this is 120, then this should be 60 degrees. So this is 30 and this is also 30 degrees. Definitely it doesn't look like 30 degrees, but it is actually, it is supposed to be 30 degrees. Okay, because this much is 120 only. It's 120, so this should be 60. Half of that will be 30. So this is 30 and this is phi, and we need to find out the angle between this angle we need to find out. 30 and this is phi. So this is how much? Cos of 30 plus phi. This is 30 and this is phi. So this remaining is 30 minus phi. So we get this angle between IC and VCB as 30 minus phi. So this W2 becomes IC into VCB into cos of 30 minus phi. What are these connections? What is the star connect? We have considered here a star connection for which we have written everything. Now for a star connection, what is IA? And it's a balanced three-phase system. This W1 reading can also be written as IA is nothing but equal to I phase, because you know that for a balanced system, IA is equal to IB, all magnitudes is equal to IC magnitude, and they all are equal to I phase. Right? So I'll just rub this and write down similarly. What about VAB and VCB? What is VAB? VAB is the voltage between two line terminals. So this magnitude will be equal to VBC magnitude, will be equal to VCB magnitude for a balanced system, which can be written as, what is this? This is nothing but the line voltage, right? Between two lines, A and B is line voltage for a star connected system. It should be equal to VL. The balanced system all are same. So that is why a common term we are using is VL. If we substitute this for W1 and W2, what we get? W1 becomes I phase multiplied by, this is I phase, and we also know that for a star connection, the phase current is equal to the line current. For a star connection, IL is equal to I phase. So instead of I phase, I'm going to write down IL. Okay, so this is IL multiplied by VL cos of 30 plus 5. Similarly, what is W2? W2 is IL to VL. IC is I phase. I phase is equal to IL into VCB is VL into cos of 30 minus 5. Isn't it? W1 and W2. And if we add W1 and W2, if we add W1 and W2, what are we getting? W1 plus W2, then IL into VL. If we take common, what is the two terms which you are getting? Cos of 30 plus 5 plus cos of 30 minus 5. What are these terms? Sum of these two, cos of 30 plus 5 plus cos of 30 minus 5, what will be this? So this gives W1 plus W2 is equal to IL into VL cos A plus B. What is the formula? What is cos of A plus B?
Cos A cos B minus sin A sin B.
Cos B minus
sin. Yeah. Right? So just apply this and tell me what is the answer. Cos of 30 plus 5 minus plus cos of 30 minus 5. The first term will be cos 30 cos 5 minus sin 30 sin 5 plus next term will be cos 30 cos 5 plus sin 30 sin 5. Right? So minus sin 30 sin 5 and plus sin 30 sin 5 will get cancelled whenever we add these two terms. So what we'll get basically, cos A cos B terms will be two times. So we'll get here two times cos 30 into cos of. I hope everyone agrees with me. So what is this basically? IL and VL multiplied by 2. Cos 30 is how much? Sin 30 is half. Cos 30 is root 3 by 2. And cos 5. So this gets cancelled and what we'll get is VL into IL. Basically root 3 also is there. So we get root 3 times VL into IL into cos of. That is W1 plus W2. And what is W root 3 VL IL cos phi? Can anyone tell me? For a star connection, let us see. For a star connection, we know VL is nothing but root 3 times V phase. And IL is equal to I phase. This we have already seen. V phase into I phase into cos of phi. And what is this basically? 3 times V phase into I phase into cos phi. Cos phi is actually telling us that the load is actually having a inductive term. But if it is purely resistive, then this cos phi will be equal to 1. And 3 times V phase, I phase. For a balanced 3 phase system, this is nothing but equal to the 3 phase power. This is nothing but the 3 phase power. 3 times V phase into I phase. If each phase power is V phase into I phase, then sum of all the 3 will be 3 times V phase into I phase. And if it is a inductive load, then cos phi term will also come. So V phase into I phase into cos phi multiplied by 3 is nothing but the 3 phase power. Right? So basically, if we are adding W1 plus W2, what is it giving us? It is giving us the 3 phase power consumed in a balanced 3 phase system. So we have just proved here with the help of this phasor diagram also that for a balanced 3 phase system, W1 plus W2 is again giving us the 3 phase power. Now, this is clear to us. This was known to us for balanced as well as unbalanced also, that W1 plus W2 is equal to 3 phase power. Now, if I do W2 minus W1, okay, we know what is W1 and W2. If I do W2 minus W1, what will we get? IL into VL is common. Now, what is the remaining? Cos of 30 minus 5 minus cos of 30 plus 5. So, what will be this term? This will be IL into VL. Cos A cos B plus sin A sin B minus cos A cos B plus sin A sin this minus is there, so plus sin A sin B again. So you can see that cos A cos B term or cos 30 cos phi term will actually get cancelled, and sin A sin B terms. So here there is a positive sin A, sin 30 sin phi. Here also there is, inside there is minus, so this minus will make it plus. So this becomes 2 times sin 30 sin phi. First terms will get cancelled. And we know that sin 30 is half. So 2 sin 30 is 1. So this will be 1. Basically, what is this giving us? W2 minus W1 is actually giving us IL into VL into sin of phi. Now if I multiply both sides by root 3, so W2 minus W1, I'm just multiplying both the sides by root 3. Then this will become root 3 times VL into IL into sin phi. Okay, so let's say this is my equation number 1. This is my equation number 2. And I am dividing equation 2 by equation number 1. So what I am getting on the left hand, and this is basically, this will also be a term, root 3 times VL into IL into sin phi. What is this term actually? Again, if I write down VL in terms of V phase into I phase, what will this this term come out to be? VL is nothing but root 3 times V phase, IL is equal to I phase, so this will be nothing but V phase into I phase to sine of phi. So this is nothing but the reactive power which is associated with the 3 phase system. So this power P which we had written here, this is the power consumed in the circuit. This is actually known as the real power or active power in the circuit, and this is always consumed. Okay, this is consumed and it is measured by the wattmeters W1 plus W2, real power or active power. But this power which we have got here, 3 times V phase into I phase into sin phi, this is nothing but the reactive power in the 3 phase system. Reactive power. This reactive power. Now what is reactive power basically? It is the power associated with the presence of inductor, because we know that, why is this term coming? Sin phi, this term is coming, phi is coming because there is an inductor present in the circuit. So it is telling us that this much amount of power is actually stored in the inductor in the magnetic field. This is not useful. We are not able to use or recover this power. This will be basically oscillating in each cycle. In some part it will consume some power, the positive half, the negative half it will return it back. So this power is actually oscillating and will not be useful in the circuit in terms of power transfer. So such a power is actually known as the reactive power, and the value is nothing but root 3 times VL into IL into sin phi, or 3 times V phase IF phase into sin phi. So this is Q pre phase. If I divide this, this is second equation and first equation. So first, second by first is nothing but Q of 3 phase divided by P of 3 phase. Can be written as, this is root 3 times W2 minus W1, right? This is the second equation divided by first equation is W1 plus W2 is equal to right hand side. This is root 3 times VL IL sin phi divided by root 3 times VL IL cos phi. So root 3 VL IL will can get cancelled. This is sin phi divided by cos phi is nothing but tan of 2 divided by 1. When we do, we'll get this equation. From here we can find out what is pi. Pi will be nothing but tan inverse of root 3 times W2 minus W1 divided by W1 plus W2. This, or it is also written as tan inverse of Q3 phase divided by P. Fine. So what is this? Phi is nothing but again the angle between voltage and current in each phase. This is known as the power factor angle. This is known as the power factor angle phi. And to find out now, if you know what is phi, what is power factor? Found out in the earlier last session also, what is power factor? It is nothing but cos of pi. Right? So basically, if you want to find out phi, cos phi, you just find out phi, that is tan inverse of root 3 times W2 minus W1 divided by W1 plus W2. Take the cos of that, you will get what is power factor. So for a balanced three phase system, okay, if we know what is W1 and W2, okay, if these values are known to you, W1 and W2, what all you can find out? What all you can find out? You can find out what is the three phase power, that is W1 plus W2. You can find out what is the three phase reactive power. What is the reactive power? I have just now found out reactive power is root 3 times W2 minus W1. Isn't it? This is nothing but root 3 times W2 minus W1. That is the reactive power. Then you can find out what is the power factor angle. Tan inverse of this Q three phase divided by P three phase. Right? And you can find out what is the power factor, which is nothing but cos of phi. So all these things you can evaluate if you know what is W1 and W2 using the two wattmeter method. I hope this is clear to everyone. Now this P3 phase and Q3 phase, if we write down, okay, the P3 phase and Q3 phase, this is real power and reactive power. Sum of these together, the phasor sum, will actually give us what is the apparent power in the three phase system, where this is your power factor angle phi. How? Because if we take, if you see here, what is P3 phase? That is root 3 VL IL cos phi, right? This is nothing but root 3 times VL to IL into cos of phi. This is nothing but root 3 times VL into IL into sine of phi. Then what is root of P3 phase square plus Q3 phase square? What are these values? This will be root of root 3 VL IL is common here, isn't it? So this will become 3 times VL square into IL square into cos square phi plus sin square phi. This is nothing but 1. And what is this? This comes out to be root 3 times VL into IL. And what is this? If we put VL value as root 3 times V phase, this becomes 3 times V phase into I phase. That is your apparent 3 phase power. Either root 3 VL into IL or 3 phase 3 times V phase into I phase. So this power S is actually known as the apparent power. Apparent power. It is basically the phasor sum of the three phase reactive power and the three phase active power. Always remember that the unit of this power in three phase P is watts. Okay. This is reactive power. It is volt ampere reactive, VAR, and for apparent power it is VA, volt into amperes. Okay, this is VAR, this is VA, that is volt into amperes. These are the units of real, reactive and apparent power. And this triangle which we have found here is also known as the power triangle. Power triangle. Where the base is three phase power. This is for a three phase system. Base is the three phase power, the perpendicular is three phase reactive power and the hypotenuse is the three phase apparent power. Apparent power is nothing but the phasor sum. So I can say that S three phase is nothing but equal to P three phase plus J times Q three phase. Okay, so this is the phasor sum of these two powers. So that is about the three phase power measurement of your 2 wattmeter method. Now one table is there which is very important, which I'm going to write down. That means if you are having W1 and W2, so write down here what is phi, the power factor, W1 is W2. These are the remarks. So let us quickly see what this table is actually telling us for the general values of phi. Okay. So when phi is 0 degree, when phi is 30 degrees, when phi is 60 degrees, when phi is 90 degrees, what will be the power factors and wattmeter readings in this experiment? So when phi is 0 degrees, what is it actually telling us? That voltage and current are in same phase in all the three phases, right? What will be cos phi? Cos phi will be equal to 1. When it is 30 degrees, this will be cos 30. Cos 30 is root 3 by 2, that is 0.866, 8667 and so on. Now 60 degrees, cos 30 is nothing but half, so 0.5. This is phi is 90, that means current and voltage, they both are at 90 degree to each other. 90 degree to each other means that what will be the power factor? Cos 90, which is 0. So power factor will become 0 here. Now if your phi is equal to 0 degree, we know that what is W1? W1 is root 3 times VL into IL into cos of 30 plus phi. And W2 is root 3 times VL into IL into cos of 30 minus phi. Isn't it? We had just written that earlier. So what will happen if phi is 0 degree? If phi is 0 degrees, these two are 0 degrees here. So this becomes cos 30, cos 30. That means W1 and W2, they both are equal because phi is 0. This 2 will be cos 30. Cos 30 is root 3 by 2. Root 3 by 2. So this will be root 3 into VL into IL into cos phi. So there is a change here. W1 and W2, root 3 term is not there. It is IL into VL into cos 30 plus phi, IL into VL into cos 30 minus phi. Correct it here. This root 3 is not there. Three phase power. So W1 is VL IL cos 30 plus phi, VL IL cos 30 minus phi. This is W1 and W2. So if phi is 0 here, then what is W1? W1 is IL by 2. What is W2? W2 is also VL into IL by 2. We can say that both the wattmeter readings will be the same. If W1, if the power factor is unity or phi is 0, then both the wattmeters will be reading the same. If phi is 30 degrees, phi is 30 degree means this is 0.866. What will happen here? This becomes cos 30 plus 30, that is cos 60. So this becomes EL into IL. Cos 60 is half L into IL by 2. What happens to this? Phi is 30, cos 30 minus 30 is 0, cos 0 is 1. So this becomes VL IL. So what can you conclude from this remarks? You can conclude that one of the wattmeter readings W2 is actually two times that of W1. Okay? So is equal to 2 times W1. Isn't it at 30 degrees? One of the wattmeter will read 2 times the other wattmeter reading. So we are just finding out at different power factors what is happening. If phi is 60 degrees, what will happen? Phi 60 means is 30 plus 60, that is 90, cos 90 is 0. W1 will become 0 itself. Whereas what happens to W2? W2 is 30 minus 60, that is minus 30. So cos of minus theta, fourth quadrant, is cos theta itself. Cos 30 is again root 3 by 2. So this becomes how much? Root 3 by 2 times VL into. What can you say that? One wattmeter. Here one of the wattmeters, one of the wattmeters will read 0. Okay? One of the wattmeters will read 0 here. And if your phi is 90 degree, cos phi becomes 0, power factor. What happens to W1? This is 90 plus, 30 plus 90. That is 120. That is second quadrant now. Cos 90 plus 30 becomes sine 30, but with a negative sign. Cos is negative in the second quadrant. So this becomes minus sine 30, that is minus 0.5. So this becomes minus VL into IL divided by 2. And what about W2? W2 is 30 minus 90, that is minus 60. So again, fourth quadrant, cos is positive only, cos 60. Cos 60 is again half, right? So this will come plus VL into IL by 2. If phi is 90 degree, power factor is 0, you can see that W1 and W2, they both are equal and opposite. Okay, you can say that they both are equal and opposite, or you can say that sum of these two will become equal to 0. Sum of these two wattmeter readings will become 0. And what does it actually tell us? If W1 and W2, they both are 0, sum of these two, sorry, not in general, sum of these two is 0, that is actually telling us that it is the total three-phase power, isn't it? The total three-phase power consumed in this circuit will be 0 if phi is 90 degree, and that is true also because if phi is 90 degree, that means either the load is a pure inductor or it is a pure capacitor. If it is a pure inductor or capacitor, no power consumed in the circuit because only the element which consumes power is a resistor. So then W1 plus W2 will come out to be 0 here. I hope this is clear to everyone. Now, if I ask you, what is the range? What comments you can generally say? If the power factor stable, you should always remember what is happening, what is the comments. Okay. If the power factor is lying between 0 to 0.5, 0 to 0.5, if the power factor is lying between this, then you can say that one of the wattmeters will read negative. One of the wattmeters will read negative. If the power factor is lying between these two points, 0 to 0.5. You can see that one wattmeter is 0 here. After that, if you go again increasing the power factor or increasing the phi or decreasing the power factor, this watt meter reading has become negative. So one watt meter will read negative. When power factor equal to 0.5, we can conclude that one watt meter will read zero. You can see here. When the power factor is greater than 0.5, between 0.5 to 1, then we can say that both watt meters are positive. Both watt meters read positive. Read positive. Now, if one of them is reading negative, what will you do? Negative reading, what does that mean? One meter is reading negative. So I told you that you are having this watt meter. There is a scale. Pointer. This scale like this. If it is reading negative, if positive deflection is this direction, if negative deflection means it is in the opposite direction and your needle will actually deflect in the opposite direction and go to the extreme left. Okay, you will not be able to measure any reading if it is reading negative. So in that case, what you have to do, what are the connections which you have for a wattmeter? I told you, you have M, L, C and V. If the wattmeter is reading negative, what is the steps you have to take? You have to interchange M and L connections. That means whatever is there connected at M, connected to L, and vice versa, that what is connected to L, connected to M. Interchange M or L. Or you can change C and V connections. So we, in this particular case, we will take only M and L interconnection change and interchange with respect to each other if it is reading negative. The current coil, basically what we are trying to do is the direction of current we are changing. At this point, current is flowing in this particular direction. If all connections are in this particular way, then M will be here and L will be here. So the current flowing through this direction will change here. So that will deflect it in the opposite direction. So once the reading is coming out to be negative, we interchange M and L. And whatever the new reading which we get here, for example, now the reading is here somewhere. We take that reading, but add a negative in front of that. Because this is actually the negative direction reading which we have taken. So that is very important to be noted, that if one of the wattmeters are reading negative, then interchange M and L connections and get the reading in the positive side. Whatever the reading you are getting, that you have to use with a negative sign in the circuit. Whenever you do W1 plus W2, so let's say if W2 is reading negative, so whatever you do the interchange and get the reading, then in that particular case, you do W1 plus minus of W. Okay, then you will get what is the actual three-phase power. Fine. So this is about your experiment number 5. Now I'll just quickly show you what is the circuit which you are supposed to do in the lab. This is the circuit here. We are having a resistive load only, we don't have any inductive load or a normal resistive load. Resistive load, when I say it, these are the lamp loads which we connect in the lab, right? Lamp loads we have seen in our previous experiments also. So you can see this is our circuit here, total circuit. This is the three phase load, lamp load, R, Y and V, and we are connecting here. This is the wattmeter W1. And this is the wattmeter W2. What are we measuring here? W1 and W2 we are measuring. Along with that, you can see that there are voltmeters, line voltages we are measuring. Okay, and line currents are also being measured. 1, 2, 3. Three line currents are also measured. Line currents will be the same as phase current because it's a star connection. And the supply. Where is the RYB coming from? This is a three-phase variac. That means this is a 415 volt 50 hertz
three-phase supply. We are connecting it through a variac, three-phase variac, and in three-phase variac, we know that we can vary from zero to the maximum value by rotating the three-phase variac like. So we get here from 0 to 415 volt variable voltage at 50 hertz. Just to be able to vary this voltage, we are using a three-phase variac. Okay, and connections, you can see W1 is between A phase and potential is between Y. So R by B, we are, we can say that this is nothing but ABC circuit. And if you are having a neutral wire separately connected, you can connect that wire also. The neutral wire. So between A and B, first wattmeter. The third watt, second wattmeter is in the C phase, or the third phase. Between C and B is your voltage wire. Fine, so this is about, and these are the apparatus as per requirement. This is the theory. Little bit of theory is also given. So you can go through that same thing which I've explained in detail. This is the procedure. What is the procedure? Everyone can look here. Make the connections as per circuit diagram. Set the variable load resistance position of all phases to the maximum value. Adjust them in order to obtain balanced load condition. So basically, maximum load value means we assume that we want maximum load to be connected in the circuit. We want balanced system, balanced three-phase system. Okay. So all the three phases we carry the same amount of load. Same load means same amount of, same number of lamps we will turn on in each phases. Now keep operating the dial of three-phase variac and then turn on the supply. Means initially we'll keep it as zero and then start varying it. Okay, this is just for safety purpose. Now by operating this three-phase variac dial, set the input phase voltage to 415 volts. So by varying this 0 to 415, we can increase from 0 and finally bring it to 415 volt value. Now we need to note the line and line voltages and line currents of individual lines. We have seen here there are meters here, right? These are voltmeters which are connected between across the lines. So these are line voltages, all the three voltmeters. These three are line currents, all the three ammeters. And you need to note the readings of wattmeters W1. Gradually increase the load in all the three phases and move down variously. So W1 and W2 for various readings of load. Load means we are turning on lamps. Let's say all the three phases we have one lamp on. Then two lamps you will turn on, three lamps you will turn on, and check all these individual needles. So you can see here, this is the observation table already made in this particular lab. So cos phi we have taken here as 1 because it is a resistive load, it is a lamp load which we are having. So it is resistive in nature. What are we measuring here? Voltmeter readings, VRY, VYB and VBR. And the line current readings IR, IY and IB. So you can take this as AB, C or CA as per your requirement. This is IA, IB and IC. You can either follow this or this. I have taken the terms ABC just to give you another way of understanding that it can also be done in the same way. Okay? ABC form or RYB. You can use RYB also, not an issue. And what are the wattmeters we are using? W1 and W. And these are the calculation points. These all are the measurements, right? We have to do for different loads. So we increase the number of lamp on, turned on in each phases. Calculations portion, what you have to do? The three phase active power will be nothing but P, which is W1 plus W2. That will be the same as root 3 times VL into IL into cos phi. So if you see, this is done by calculation and this is the addition of W1 plus W2. So you can see that from W1 plus W2, whatever we are getting, and from the formula what we are getting, it is not exactly the same but to each other. This 2060, this 2050, 2620, 2618. So there is some difference in the reading here. Why? Because we are using measuring instruments. Because of which there will be some errors, small errors while measuring, but essentially these two should be equal. the power measured in the 3 phase. Now for writing in the record, what you have to do, you have to write the sample calculation. Sample calculation for example, serial number 1 you are calculating. Okay? Serial number 1, or this is serial number 1. You are calculating 3-phase active power, that is root 3 times VLI. VL is known to you, IL is known to you, cos phi is known to you, 1. Similarly, reactive power and apparent power, root 3 VLI. So this sample calculation for any of the readings you can do. Write down the result, conclusion, and answer the quiz questions. Also, you people can see that there is, in the end, there is a link which is given here, virtual lab experiment link. Okay, so you can click on this link and we will be able to open a, if I just click on this, if I click on this, it will actually go. So it will go to the tab here. You can see this is a virtual lab system. Here both balanced and unbalanced load you can connect here. Balanced and unbalanced. So just go through this to understand how to implement this. What you have to do is just follow the procedures here. This is just for your own understanding, you can do this. So go through these balanced and unbalanced load sections. Here is for balance. Go through the procedure and do and click on this. For example, here I am setting the value 100 volt 50 hertz. Okay. Now balance load value 25 25 25 ohms is given here. What you have to do? You have to compare these values. So individually we have to get, okay. Please switch on the supply first to get the reading. So how to turn on the supply, just click on this R button. This is turning on, so you are getting some readings here. Whatever readings you are getting, you can click on this and add, fill the table. So it will be filling those values in the observation. Now you can change the load here. You can make it 30, right? 30 ohms in all the three phases, balanced load. And again, turn on the supply and you'll get some readings. You can fill, click on fill the table and get those readings. Maybe for different, for example, I am making it 50 ohms. Again, turn on this and fill the table. So you can take some 5 readings and see that total power is coming out to be the, this is the calculated power here, and this is the measured power, P1, W1 plus W2. You see that this almost comes out to be the same for all readings. So this is just for your verification. Same thing, you can go for unbalanced system also, in which you can individually have different loads, different load resistances here to keep, to make the load, three phase load to be unbalanced. So this is an exercise which you can do from your own side. For your understanding, this is given to you. Experiment lab record is concerned, you just have to this observation table, calculation, result, conclusion, and quiz questions. Remaining theory portion, you have already in this, circuit diagrams is this, AM and apparatus you have to write down. Already I have also explained in detail here, all this portion. If you want, I can share with you this document also. Yeah, and one more thing is there, that there is a video also for this experiment, hardware, which we are doing the experimentation in our lab. So I'll share that video also with you people in the same folder. People have access to the Google Drive folder. Everyone is able to access
yes,
that?
Sir.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
So I will be sharing a video also. So while if I play it right now, you may not be able to properly listen because of different bandwidth. I'll share it in the Google Drive folder. All of you have to watch that video. So let me just share it now itself so that access it. if you open the drive folder now, you can see that I have added here experiment 5. All of you can check. It is a big file, actually around 1.6 GB. So you can download it as per your own and watch it as per your own convenience, for your own internet data and everything. So experiment number 5, 2 wattmeter method, that is the name of the file. So you can access that video from the Google Drive. I hope everyone is able to access that. Okay. Yeah. So watch that video and just go through it. Already the same, whatever I've explained in the theory, that is being added there also. Explain that, you will be able to understand how we are doing it in the lab. Okay. And watch that. In case of any doubts, you people can ask me in the next lab session. And in next lab session, I'll be taking your assessment. Okay, so everyone has to prepare from experiment number 1 to 5 and complete the lab record and submit it as per the deadline. The next lab mein jab aap aoge, 5th experiment tak ka aapka lab record complete hona chahiye. Doubts regarding that? You just save this file and add this. If you do, you want this document?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
You just save and add now only, so that it is, you can quickly refer now itself. Experiment number 5. Yeah, so I am adding now. So this is almost added. Yeah, now it is added in the Google Drive folder. I hope you people are able to access. Just check. It is named as experiment 5, 2 wattmeter method notes, underscore notes. Okay, you people can go through this. Also, this. Manual also I will add and copy now. I'll just rename it. So everything is now added to the Google Drive and you people can access it. The recording link of this session will also be updated in the Google Doc recording link folder. Is there any doubt regarding this?
No, sir.
Fine. So go through this material. Go through the lecture recording also. In case of any doubts, you can ask me in the next session. And prepare well from experiment number 1 to 5. I'll be asking questions based on that and based on your lab record. So submit your records before the next lab session. All experiment number 1 to 5. Fine. So we'll end the session today and we'll meet in our next session on Tuesday. Right, you all can leave the meeting now.
Thank you, sir.